Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to another edition of the Wilds War Cry. I am your host, Stephen Wilds. Today, with me, I have the long-lost distant relative, the cousin, perhaps, of Killer Kowalski. This is Kovic.
Hello, everybody. Kovic here.
Yeah, Kovic's here, peeps. All right, good. So, Kovic here, as he so announced himself, of course, has not really been on the wrestling scene as of late. I'm trying to ease him back into it. It's just a work in progress. But I did get him to agree to go watch some old wrestling. And for whatever reason, he decided, of course, that he wanted to watch what a lot of wrestling fans have probably listed as one of their least favorite WrestleManias of all time. Why was it exactly you wanted us to watch WrestleMania 9?
That's a very good question. Basically, it's one that stands out for me. I used to watch a lot of wrestling with my grandfather, and this is one I kind of remember. I think I was around 8 years old when this WrestleMania came out, and it has a few matches that I definitely remember. Like, iconically remember, I guess you'd say.
Sure, okay. And I can see how this would stand out as an iconic WrestleMania in the first set of 10, but I don't know. We'll talk about that. For me, personally, I was mostly exposed to wrestling at a younger age by a friend of mine who had all of the WrestleManias up to that point recorded on VHS, and we would go over to his place and watch them. But I don't think we ever watched WrestleMania 9 until I was in high school, because he never showed that one. He claimed it was one of the worst, if not the worst. And therefore, it took until finally we had just been through all the other WrestleManias. He was like, I guess we should watch 9 now. So let's talk about, first of all, where was this WrestleMania? Where did it take place?
All right, this took place at Caesar's Palace in Las Vegas. And it was well known as the world's largest toga party. At least that was the punchline they were going for.
Right. That was the tagline they were hyping it with. So this is also has two things I want to talk about. Two of my favorite people were hosting. We have Gorilla Monsoon. And this is also the first announcing WrestleMania for Jim Ross.
I actually did not know that.
Yeah, I believe he actually says it towards the beginning, but that was his first one. And the other thing, of course, that makes this kind of a big deal is I believe this is also the first WrestleMania to be held outdoors, which they've done several times since then.
Yeah, as far as I can remember, it was the first one.
The other reason a lot of people seem to remember this one, of course, are the elaborate entrances. We had a lot of beautiful women coming out with some of the wrestlers. We had someone with an elephant, you know, people being carried out like royalty. And, of course, no one can forget that entrance for Bobby the Brain Heenan on the camel.
Yeah. And remember what Macho Man did to him when he fell off.
Right. Are you a Heenan fan? Were you a Heenan fan?
Yes, definitely a Heenan fan.
It looked like most of the comedic moments for this WrestleMania were in the beginning. They did something in the beginning and didn't do what I kind of loathe now in a lot of more modern WrestleManias, where there were no musical performances, there were no comedic skits. None of the action was really broken up except by the individual segments in between, but those were all backstage segments.
I don't really have too much of a memory of that right now. Sorry.
Right. That's all right. The other thing that I guess was kind of a funny moment is, so the announcer, of course, for this event was Howard Finkel, whom they called Finkus Maximus, for just to go with the theme. I don't know. It made me kind of chuckle, and then it made me kind of sad right after that.
It was good.
All right. So you told me something very interesting that I didn't think about, but Raw, as a television show, actually started about 3 months prior to this event.
That is correct.
So this is also the first WrestleMania that had the advantage of having this extra build from weekly televised storylines. So there was some good stuff, you know, helping to build the feuds and the plots for this WrestleMania, right?
Yes, there was.
Now, you went back and watched a few of those episodes of Raw. Just give me a brief thing. What did you think of those?
Well, that was like very early in the days of Raw, so there wasn't a whole lot going on in those early episodes. There were 1-hour episodes back then, too, so like 44 minutes. airtime. I mean, it's there's not really much to say about them. They tried their best. I don't know what to say about them, man. Sorry. Kind of like a wasted airtime for me.
I know what to say about it. It was 44 minutes, and therefore I have to sit through 3 hours of Raw every week now.
Yes.
Oh, God. Okay. Thanks, Vince. So there was actually one match that was supposed to take place. There was a very small build for it on Raw, from what I understand. But due to time constraints, there was originally going to be a match between Bam Bam Bigelow and Kamala that got scrapped. I'm a big Bam Bam Bigelow fan, so I kind of hate that. But time is time, you know?
Yeah.
But we did get a dark match. That dark match was between Tito Santana, who is actually a friend of mine's favorite wrestler, though I don't think he knows why, and Papa Shango.
Yeah, I wish I got to see that one though, but that was one that I missed out on watching.
I only saw clips from that one, and I don't think we missed too much, but it's dark matches. It's kind of interesting how nowadays all the dark matches are televised either on YouTube or on the actual network before the pay-per-view events. And so people don't miss this stuff as much. But there are a lot of matches that just if you weren't in the audience, you probably never saw, or most fans won't get to see. And I find that kind of interesting.
Yeah, I remember going to some live events where you got to see matches that never aired on TV. So it was
Right.
definitely something cool to see.
So tell me real quick, overall, what did you think of the whole theme, the mystique of it? You have Caesar's Palace, this is outdoors arena. It's been done up to look like this Roman Coliseum theme. You had a lot of the WWE staff and personnel, wearing certain outfits to go with the theme. Overall, what did you think about how this WrestleMania presented itself?
For the time, it's obviously stayed with me. Like, this is 20 years on now, and it's one WrestleMania that I still remember to this day. So whatever they did with all their attire, with all their setup, they did it right in that I can't forget it.
Okay. No, it's definitely, it's one that stands out. I have people who aren't even huge wrestling fans who sometimes won't remember which WrestleMania it is, but say, well, wasn't there the one where everybody rode on, animals and it was done like a Roman Coliseum? Oh, yeah, WrestleMania 9. That a lot of times you still get people who aren't even huge wrestling fans, they kind of remember it because it stood out more.
Yeah, exactly.
And now there aren't a lot of other WrestleManias. There have been other WrestleManias with themes, but none like this big, I think. None that stood out this much as such a base, simple theme that they went so hard into.
Yeah, not that I can think of off the top of my head right now.
Okay, so let's talk about some of the matches. We're going to go down the list. We're going to talk a little bit about each match. And I just kind of want to get your opinion, what you thought, what you remember about it, and also just in general, maybe, who you thought benefited the most from it. First up, Tatanka. And he was taking on Shawn Michaels. But this is kind of an interesting situation because Tatanka was currently being valeted, managed, however you want to say it, by Sherry. Sensational Sherry had previously worked with Shawn Michaels, but there was an incident. Why did Sensational Sherry turn on Shawn Michaels?
You're asking me a question I probably should have researched more, my friend.
There was an incident with a mirror. There was an incident where I believe he was about to get hit with a mirror and he pulled Sherry in the way. He was about to get hit with something and he was using her as a shield. So she turned on him. And instead, Shawn Michaels came out with what some, I guess, might say is the opposite of Sensational Sherry,
Yeah.
as he came out with Luna Vachon. And I think this is really early in Vachon's WWE career. I think this was pretty, maybe not her first event, but it was pretty close.
Yeah, I don't remember much before that with her.
The other thing that we should kind of point out, this match was also for the IC title belt. And this is back when the IC title belt was really kind of seen as the prestigious belt of the working class wrestler, the mid-card crown that signified who was, due to eventually get a push to the top. But these are the guys that were a lot of times seen as the hard workers. And I actually think Tatanka is deserving of that. He's a pretty hard worker. But I believe Michaels actually had the belt at this point.
Yeah, Tatanka was probably one of my favorites when I was a kid watching this. was definitely a fan of his. His in-ring just presence was very fun to watch, and not to mention he was a great wrestler to me.
This entrance that he did also proves, if you've ever doubted it, which I hope no one listening to this podcast ever did, Shawn Michaels is a true entertainer at heart, and that man knows how to make an entrance, and there's a reason we call him Mr. WrestleMania.
I like how you said at heart, heartbreak kid, kind of throwing something in there.
You know what? I don't do puns. I don't do puns. All right. So, like I said, I think Tatanka's a good wrestler. What are your opinions on him?
Like I said, I was always a fan of Tatanka, and at the time, Shawn Michaels was not someone that I was really following as much. So I wasn't really sure what to expect with this particular match, but I was definitely rooting for Tatanka at the time, because I was, like I said, I was around 8 years old, so I really enjoyed what he brought to the ring every time he came out.
There was a really great moment where Michaels came off the top rope, and I believe Tatanka actually caught him and turned it into a slam, like a power slam or something like that. And the timing was perfect. Like, you can tell that these two guys worked well together. You know, Michaels had several moments in the match where he made Tatanka look good, and there were moments where Tatanka made him look good. They seemed to have a good chemistry.
Yeah, that was a very solid wrestling match for sure.
I'm not shocked. I mean, I knew, you know, one, Shawn Michaels may not be my favorite wrestler ever, but he's up there, and he always delivers.
I will admit, I was kind of surprised that with how good that match was, that it was basically the opening match for that pay-per-view.
Yeah, but that doesn't, you know, on a big show like WrestleMania or Royal Rumble or any of your big shows, you want a match that's going to get the audience into the show early on. You want to make sure that you're pulling them in and you're getting those excitement levels up and you're encouraging them to keep the excitement levels up through the whole show.
Yeah, I get that. I just, 'cause some of the other matches, as we'll get to, the card placement was a little bit funny in this pay-per-view.
Right. I definitely see why you're saying that, but I guess also, you know, if you're booking, you're thinking about pacing. And some WrestleManias have really good pacings, others don't. You know, some you don't even realize the boring matches because they're usually a little bit shorter, or you know, you have them sandwiched in between two amazing matches, so it just doesn't sit as much.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, cool. So Tatanka wins the match, but it's due to count out. And of course, you know, he was in the middle of a winning streak. He had a really long winning streak. I forget exactly how long it went, but this was during the middle of that. So this was a way to keep the belt on Michaels, but to give Tatanka the win. Not a very surprising, even though I actually didn't remember who won the match. You know, it wasn't a
Yeah.
surprising ending. Kind of saw it coming.
I would say that, I mean, anytime I watch a pay-per-view, even to this day, even though I'm a little behind on current wrestling, is it was always a disappointment, especially at one of the main pay-per-views like a WrestleMania, when you saw a count out or kind of a what I'd call a storyline progression style ending.
Right.
Like I don't want that at a main event pay-per-view like that.
I think it's one of those deals where it's like, okay, is this going to actually progress the story to a better match? Do I want this storyline to keep going? And also, you have to look at the rest of the card. Do you have a lot of other kind of no contest or screwy endings? Because if you have a, you know, a card full of those, then yeah, it's gonna make it not taste, leave a bad taste in your mouth.
Yeah, there's definitely something coming up in this pay-per-view we'll get to.
Yeah. All right. So after the match, also, just to kind of, I guess, make the crowd happy, and because, you know, we want to get them involved, we have Luna and Sherry getting into an altercation outside of the ring after the match.
Yes, they did.
Yeah. And I will say this, it was a little rough. I think Luna might have actually, you know, Sherry, of course, is by no means, if you ever listen to stories about her, she was no wuss. You know, she was ready to throw down. So I think she and Luna probably agreed, you know, hey, it's WrestleMania. Let's, you
Let's
know, let's
make it
do
look
this.
good.
Yeah,
Yeah.
and I give them that credit. So overall, I would definitely say this is one of the better matches on the card. I would actually say this is one of the matches that I will probably remember a little bit more. And if I were to go back and watch to maybe pick out like some really good WrestleMania matches, this would probably be the match on this particular card on WrestleMania 9 that I would go back and rewatch.
Yeah, I actually had this as my favorite match of the whole card.
I think we're in agreement on that. Okay.
Yeah.
So in between a lot of these matches, you had backstage segments. And I kind of pointed this out to you a while ago, and I want to say it's good that they did these and not, there were no concerts, there were no real comedy sketches. All the comedy was done in these backstage segments, but the segments actually felt like they were kind of pushing the storylines and pushing the matches and all that. So they kept it kind of focused, which was good. There's one segment that doesn't do that, and we'll get to that in a little bit. But this particular one, of course, was a backstage segment with Gene Okerlund and the Steiner brothers. Now, how weird is it looking at Scott Steiner now or then and knowing what he looks like now?
Back then he had the full head of hair,
Wasn't
but
dyed any or bleached any weird colors, and he didn't look quite as roided out.
not quite, but he was getting there even in 93 when
Oh
this
yeah,
was.
he was a huge dude. He's huge. All right, so who did the Steiner brothers take on, Kovac?
They took on the head shrinkers.
And do you know who the head shrinkers are?
God, it was Samu and Fatu.
Yeah, Fatu, whom you may better know actually as Rikishi.
Yep.
Yeah, and for those of you who don't know, Rikishi was with the company for a very long time. He was head shrinker. I want to say he had another gimmick, but then he came out as Rikishi. And of course, he still makes a few visits now and then because his sons, the Usos, wrestle in WWE.
Are they still on the main cards? Or
They
did they?
are.
Okay.
Yeah.
Man, I really got to get back into watching wrestling, don't I?
You should. That's what we're doing this. I'm trying to convince you. All right. So let's talk for a second here about this match because these are four really big dudes.
Yeah, this was a brawler match, I guess would be the way I'd explain
Yeah.
my opinion on it. But then again, the Steiner brothers were both fairly good at wrestling maneuvers as well,
Oh yeah.
especially for their size. They were quite talented wrestlers, still are, to be honest.
I don't want to speak disparagingly of Scott Steiner because I'm afraid he'll find me in an alleyway somewhere. But no, he used to be a much better wrestler. He's always been a power guy, but I swear in the older stuff he looked much more like a technical wrestler.
Nays probably went more along the brute force line nowadays.
Right. There were some really good hot tags in this. There were some really good moments with the head shrinkers where they do their signature headbutts and stuff like that.
Yep.
The flying headbutts off of the top, or when people mention the head shrinkers, this is a good example, that they mention from that because it's a moment that stands out to a lot of people.
Yeah, that's probably one of the first people I've seen do the flying headbutts. Because at the
Right.
time, this was around the time I barely got into wrestling, so that's another reason why it's probably still so much in my memory.
And I will say that the moment where Rick Steiner caught someone while he was on top of someone else's shoulders. You remember the moment I'm talking
Yes,
about?
I do.
I actually, for a second, was like, whoa, okay, did not expect that. I didn't see that coming. But again, WrestleMania, you pull out all the stops, right?
Yes.
I think that was probably the highlight of that match overall.
Oh, I'd say the highlight of that match was the way it went down, because I laughed hysterically with how bad it was.
Oh, okay, well, yeah. What did you think overall? What is your overall opinion of this?
Wasn't a bad match. I mean, you couldn't really expect too much from basically two hard-hitting teams.
Yeah.
I mean, they did. It was a entertaining enough match. Like, I was not angry at the match when I watched it. It wasn't a bad match or anything. It just was a meh kind of match, like forgettable, but okay.
Okay, I got that.
Except for the ending. The ending was awful.
Okay. For those who may not have seen it, tell them about the ending.
All right, basically the Steiners won because Scott Steiner did the Frankensteiner. But if you go back to the video and watch how badly that Frankensteiner was executed,
Oh, yeah, you're right.
it was sold extremely well. Basically, you would have thought The Rock just took a stunner. It was sold that well, because basically the Frankensteiner hit all air. It was the head hit air,
Yeah.
but he dropped. Like it was bad. But they played it off well enough, and I laughed hysterically, like I said. So overall, good enough.
I'm actually glad you mentioned that. I actually forgot how poorly that went down. Maybe I blocked it out. I just didn't think about it. All right. All right, cool. Well, I thought that that was kind of a meh ending that led into a very meh segment, once again with Mean Gene, but this time with Doink the Clown. And he had a desecrated statue or something like that. It was weird.
Well, Doink. I mean,
it's Doink. Yeah. All right. But this next match, you know, since they're keeping in line here, of course, is Doink versus Crush. Do you remember Crush?
Very, not a lot, but I do. It was also, was it Bryan Adams? I think that's Crush?
Okay. Yes.
I believe so. Like I said, I'm trying to get back into all this wrestling stuff, trying to remember all these things.
I'm pretty sure you're right. I know this particular version of Doink was when he was played by Matt Osborne, who's kind of considered to be the main person who has played Doink for good reason.
Yeah, he's the one that I pretty much remember.
Yeah. All right. What overall did you think about the match? Talk to me about it.
Well, being a Doink the Clown match with Dink as well, you knew the gimmick was going to be hilarious. You knew it was going to be a gimmicky kind of match, even though he was up against the massive guy that was Crush.
Now, this is really weird, too, because this whole thing started apparently for no reason from what I got, because the video package they showed and what little bit we saw on Raw, apparently Doink and he were tag team partners, but then Doink attacked him with a prosthetic arm.
You know, I did not catch that part, but it does sound like that would be something that happened with Doink.
Yeah. I have never personally been a huge Doink fan, but he's a good worker, and I see why people think, you know, I see why they thought the gimmick might work. What did you think of the gimmick overall?
Well, nowadays when I rewatched it, it was pretty bad. But growing up, I did enjoy watching Doink matches as a kid. Even back then, it felt like it was more kid-oriented with what they had him doing, especially with, we'll get into it for this match, with the whole switcheroo thing and stuff like that.
Yeah.
It was more enjoyable as a kid probably watching Doink matches than it would be now.
Sure. I think also, I don't know. Like I said, he's a good worker, and like there were moments in the match where I was like, okay, well, I'm kind of interested. But the big payoff, of course, of this match is when the second Doink, played by Steve Kern, shows up. And I don't know. That was just really weird. Watching, for some reason, clowns don't bother me, but watching two clowns mimic each other, just, I wonder if I should just put on Killer Clowns from Outer Space or something.
You mean the end part with the mirror game?
Yeah.
Or when the referees came out to look under the ring?
That was pretty funny, actually. Like I said, there were parts, I guess, that were okay to that. But overall, this is one of the matches that I was like, I missed a Bam Bam Bigelow match for this.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. Because I would have much preferred watching Bam Bam Bigelow in a match.
Right.
But it was entertaining, though. I mean, I will say, for what it was.
Yeah. Okay. I agree with that. The next segment, and all right, so this is Todd Pettingill, whom he worked for WWE for a while. I don't know. I was never a Todd Pettingill fan. And I can't tell. We're going to play a game called Is This Segment Racist? It's the segment with the Asian photographers. Do you remember the one I'm talking about?
Let's see.
It was right after the Doink match.
Yeah, he was in the front row.
Yeah.
I think with the camera, the long lens camera. I think I remember what you're talking about.
But they had the most stereotypical Asian photographers there.
Yes.
And there was like a whole group of them. I was like, is this some type of just, you know, racially themed joke that I'm just not getting?
God, I wish I wrote down what he said, because I remember, like, Todd, whatever his name was, said something.
Go, yeah.
He said something out there next to that guy before they cut to the next match or the next interview. I can't remember what he said, though, but I remember laughing.
Yeah. His name is Pettingill. I'm pretty sure I have it spelled wrong here, but that's his name.
He's forgettable for me, so that's probably why I don't remember it.
Yeah, he did a lot of recap stuff for the company. He did a lot of the little videos where he would like advertise, like, "Hey, the WWE's coming to your area," you know, stuff like that. It was just an employee that got a lot of airtime, but no one's gonna hold it against you if you don't remember him.
Well, it's not that I do remember the little scenes with him popping out and all that kind of stuff where he'd talk about upcoming things and that. He's not someone I really cared to watch or what he had
Sure,
to say.
sure, sure.
Similar to Michael Cole.
Oh, okay. We're taking shots at Michael Cole now, huh? All right, let's talk about this next match because I literally have maybe two notes for this entire match because it's a squash match.
Because it's a snore fest.
I'm gonna stick with squash match. It's Bob Backlund, crazy man himself, versus Razor Ramon. First of all, how much do you know about Bob Backlund?
Bob Backlund, I basically only know from his return, which basically started here in the early 90s, but he was already past his era
He was.
at this point. So, I mean, at the time, Razor Ramon was still kind of an up and comer, I guess you'd say. He wasn't as,
Yeah, he's
you
pretty
know.
fresh still.
Yeah, but to see him go against Bob Backlund was disappointing, to say the least.
Yeah, well, because Razor dominates him.
Yeah, it was bad.
Look, there are one-sided matches, and you know, we kind of joked about being a squash match, which you really wouldn't call this a squash match, but this was completely one-sided. And for those of you who don't know anything about Bob Backlund, take a second. He had a really nice, extensive career before this return that we're talking about here. He was an amazing wrestler. Okay, amazing might be pushing him. He's a really good
Well, he was
wrestler.
a submission tech. I
Yeah.
mean, he was a submission guy. Didn't he have that chicken wing or
He had the
whatever?
chicken wing. He had the
Yeah.
chicken wing that he was famous for. I just remember, isn't this the guy that Razor Ramon, I'm sorry, that Diesel beat out? He beat him at a house show to win the world title. I think that's actually not that long from where we're at right now.
It could be, but I can't remember that part.
Yeah. I almost watched this match twice because I had so few notes and I was like, maybe I missed something, but then I realized that would just be a waste of
I have
time.
three sentences on the whole match. That's all I wrote.
I'm curious, what were your three sentences?
Well, it was just basically saying, I don't know basically why this match occurred in the first place, because it was
Yeah.
kind of pointless.
Yeah. I don't know what the build up to it was. I have no clue why these two
I
were fighting.
don't know. Then I basically wrote the comment of Bob Backlund, yeah, he was an excellent wrestler in his era, a very well-known skilled submission tech kind of thing. But Razor Ramon being faced against him just felt like a slap in the face to Razor Ramon to me. Because he should have been getting pushed, as he was fairly soon after this, pushed higher up the card. But this match just annoyed me. I did not like it. I did not see the reason it had to be at WrestleMania at all.
Yeah, I agree. Like I said, that we could sit here and make this joke on hype, but there were probably plenty of matches that the Bam Bam Kamala match would have been, you know, a good replacement for.
Yeah. Although the
So,
next match is going to be much more fun to talk about.
yeah, I hope so. I hope so. So there is a segment, you know, as there has been between each match with Mean Gene Okerlund and Money Inc. Now, I grew up with a guy whose last name was Dollar. And his favorite wrestler was the Million Dollar Man, Ted DiBiase. And I'll admit, I'm a fan. I like the 90% of what I've seen from the Million Dollar Man, Ted DiBiase. I was a little upset a lot of times when he came out because you're thinking he's going to wrestle, but he ends up just, you know, managing or getting someone else to do his dirty work. But that's what also made him a great heel. However, there's some really interesting parts to this match, and we're going to get into all of that. But let's talk about the setup. Who are they facing here, Cody?
They were facing Hulk Hogan and Brutus Beefcake, otherwise known as the Mega Maniacs at the time.
The Mega Maniacs. Do you think that was a good idea for them to call themselves the Mega Maniacs?
I just think it was a bad idea to have them together as a team.
It probably was. All right, so their feud, of course, I believe at this point was with Brutus, and Hulk Hogan had either, I think he had just returned, right? At this
Yeah,
point?
because, yeah, he was just coming back, I think.
Right. So, Money Inc. at this point, they're the tag team champions.
Yeah, they were. And this, I know where you're going with this, so I'll let you take it there.
Yeah. All right. So, first of all, let's just go with this. This match is good. It has a lot of back and forth. It has a lot of cheating, a lot of hot tags. There's a lot of storytelling in this, and it's a really good mix of wrestling and storytelling in the ring. Now, there's this huge setup after, or, I'm sorry, before, everything that happens, but a lot of the storytelling really took place in the ring. However, what's interesting about the storytelling, the setup beforehand, is that it kind of had to be improvised a little bit, and that's because Hulk Hogan showed up with a black eye. So they added this element to the story that the Million Dollar Man paid some people to rough Hogan up a little bit. Okay, that makes sense. But in reality, and they incorporated it, like Million Dollar Man even talks about doing it. So in reality, though, there are two stories. One is the official WWE story about how this black eye came about. And that was through a water jet ski accident. Possible. Okay. Sure. We'll let you guys be the judge of this. But the other rumor is that the black eye was actually obtained that morning because of a confrontation between Hulk Hogan and Randy Macho Man Savage. This supposed confrontation was over Macho Man's, they may have been divorced at that point, I'm not sure, but they were separated at least. Wife Elizabeth Hewlett. And all this was because of a supposed affair that Hogan may or may not have had with Miss Elizabeth. So, now that we have all that out of the way, I think this is one of the most interesting things to me about WrestleMania 9. I hate that it kind of happened during this match because, like I said, this was a more decent match. It was more entertaining, at least, than a lot of the others. But, there was a lot of rumors flying around, and I don't know. Do you have a theory? Do you have a theory on this?
I honestly can't side with the way the storyline went. Like the way the WWE, I guess we'd say, wanted
Sure.
you to believe the story went. Only because I've seen a fair amount of black eyes. And the way Hulk Hogan looked, not myself, but I mean, we've all pretty much seen what black eyes look like.
Sure.
And when Hulk Hogan came out, that looked really fresh. It
Oh,
didn't
yeah.
look like days before or even a day before, because it should have been larger
Yeah.
if it was more than a night. It just didn't look right. It looked like, and even his eye was so red, it looked like that was something that occurred like 6 hours prior or
Right.
something. But
Yeah,
we have to go with it.
and I just can't imagine that Hulk Hogan, the, oh, WrestleMania's today. I think I'm going to do some early morning jet skiing. I don't know.
He probably did something else early morning.
Yeah. God. All right. So before we talk about the match anymore, can you explain Brutus the Barber Beefcake's mask to me?
I have no idea.
He's
I have.
wearing this mask, and I'm willing to bet if we had watched more of Raw before this, might have known. And I know it has some, it's a storyline thing why he's wearing the mask, but I don't know. It just looked really weird. Now, I'm not a Brutus fan. I don't know why. I just never got into the character. I never got into any of his matches. I'm sure he's fine as a wrestler. The few things I've seen from him were horrible, but I don't know. What do you think about Brutus?
Pretty much the same. I've never been really a fan of his wrestling skills or whatever you want to say in the ring, or his story, his character, any of that. Never really cared. Just kind of pushed him out to the side.
Yeah.
Although he was with Hulk Hogan in this match, and at the time, definitely enjoyed watching Hogan matches.
Oh, okay. So you
For
were
the
a Hogan fan?
for the entertainment value. I mean, the guy, I wouldn't consider him Hulk Hogan a great in-ring wrestler all the time. But he was definitely entertaining and could do the promo thing and really get you excited to watch a match. Like I said, I'm basically telling you my feelings from being 8 years old, not.
Sure. No, I get that
So
totally.
yeah, if I was staying like from my age now, rewatching it, then it's just cheesy. It's not as good. as it was when I originally watched it. But the match was. It was a very solid match, because, I mean, DiBiase, Irwin R. Scheister, and that, it was a very well-fought match with a lot of funny moments in and out of it. But, yeah, I'd never been a Beefcake fan, though, that's for sure.
Okay, I get that. And I can agree with that. So, this match, like I said, it had some good wrestling. It had a couple of really good segments, especially... not their fault, but you could tell that Money Inc., you know, Irwin R. Scheister and Ted DiBiase had been working together more recently, so a lot of their stuff looked a lot more fluid than what the other team was doing. There were some referee shenanigans, and there was this whole briefcase full of money that got involved, especially at the end where Hogan was throwing out the money and it apparently was real money.
Yeah, as far as I remember it was, but I don't think he gave out too much of it.
Yeah.
But wasn't there a part where the referee, was that Earl Hebner in that match?
I think so.
I think it was a young Earl Hebner compared to what we were used to later on.
Right, yeah. Hey, man, I think he's still refereeing in TNA to this day.
I think he is. But there was a part where Money Inc. was, like, walking away from the match in order to keep their belts by disqualification or...
Right, yeah.
However, and then at the time... it was pretty cool to see the referee basically announce that, get back to the ring or I'll pull your belts from you.
Mm-hmm.
So that kind of got the crowd back into it, because, like I said, at that point it was kind of a stalemate where, okay, they're going to walk away, the match is going to end, bravo, congratulations. But it was a cool way of extending the match.
It's weird how in wrestling sometimes referees have that power and other times they don't.
Well, there was also an additional referee in that match by the name of Mr. Jimmy Hart.
Yes. I forgot about that part, but for those of you who know the Mouth of the South, Jimmy Hart, you know he loves his jackets, and apparently he decided that this particular one, the inside, it'd be reversible so that he could be a referee.
Yeah, he did.
But so,
and he proved to us that he could count to three.
Yeah.
It was fantastic.
He's a great musician. I don't know if I'd want to be a referee, though. I guess one of the sad things about this is I didn't realize how quick it came after this, because I wasn't actively watching it as much when this came about, but not long after this, the tag champs, Money Inc., actually did lose the belts, and not long after that is when Ted DiBiase actually retired. So that's kind of a sad thing, I guess, that this was their last big feud.
Yeah, but DiBiase at that time was getting kind of up there, I guess.
Sure.
And I don't know what IRS ended up doing. I thought he still stuck around for a little while.
Yeah, he did. Okay, so overall, this would probably be my number two or three as far as matches go. You know, I put that Shawn Michaels match up there. This one, I really enjoyed watching this, even though I didn't understand all of it, and there were parts that I was questioning, but, you know.
Yeah, I'd probably put this as... near the top. I mean, it's probably going to be around a three spot, because I think I'll have to put something else as a two, but the Tatanka or Shawn Michaels thing is still going to stick at number one for me.
Sure, sure. So there was another segment with Todd Pettingill. I didn't write notes for it because it was really short and bad and just kind of pandering. But the segment with Mean Gene Okerlund and Mr. Perfect. So I always remember these videos that Mr. Perfect used to do where he'd like hit the baseball and catch the pencil. You know, he did the vignettes where he was perfect, right? That was his gimmick. And I've seen some backstage stuff talking about how he would actually, during practice, he would mess it up like 10, 20 times, and then like the camera would roll and he would just somehow knock it out of the park like the first or second take, which is really cool. But he wasn't so perfect in this, because he actually messed up two of his lines in this interview.
Yeah, it was pretty noticeable.
Yeah, it was, oh, bad. But I'm a Curt Hennig fan. I was a big fan of Mr. Perfect, not just in WWE, but in WCW. So it makes me kind of sad that for whatever reason, Lex Luger was getting the push at this point, because he had to face the narcissist, Lex Luger.
Yeah. And this was at the time where Lex Luger had all the mirrors and everything, too, so...
Oh, yeah, he had this great entrance with the ring girls, and they all brought in their own mirrors, and they did... Yeah, I mean...
Yeah, it was full Lex Luger time in this era.
The only thing I will say that's kind of weird about this is I'm not used to Mr. Perfect being a face. Most of the time that I was really watching Mr. Perfect, he was always a heel. But it was interesting to see him get a really cool crowd reaction when he came out.
Yeah, because I don't think a lot of people liked Lex Luger at this point, because they really played that character off where most of the crowd was against him. So
yeah.
I guess they kind of had to go.
That's what they're supposed to do. Yeah.
No, but I mean, like, they had to go towards Mr. Perfect as the face for this match, I guess.
Right. I get what you're saying. Yeah. And you know, if you gotta work with someone, Mr. Perfect's a really good person to work with. He was really good in the ring, but he was also supposed to be really good to have as his own opponent. So, go ahead.
I'm just saying, like, overall, though, both of those guys are fairly good in the ring. I mean,
Luger's not bad in the ring. And for his size, he actually does a lot well. I always found Luger a little bit boring.
Yeah. He basically would do the same couple maneuvers over and over, and then the torture rack and all that kind of stuff.
Right. That's an interesting point there, because I would say out of every match, except for one more that we're going to talk about, this was one of the slowest paced matches on the entire card.
It was very slow. It was almost like they had a little chat before each motion. Like, what should I do next? I'm going to suplex you now.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, it's fine, but knowing how well he can go, how well Curt Hennig can go, I have to wonder if he slowed down to match Lex.
Or if they just had no idea of what they were doing, like, going into the match, and they had to just kind of off the cuff it, like, okay, we're going to do this, and slowly progress through it.
You think this was one of those matches where they didn't plan ahead and they thought they would call in the ring and it just didn't work as well?
Yeah, you never know. Like, maybe they had a couple of things set up, like the finishing and all that kind of stuff, but then they were like, let's just take it one step at a time.
Right.
I'll say about that match is the most memorable part of that entire match for me was Luger's entrance.
It was Luger's entrance.
It was a
screwy finish, you know.
That was with the ref didn't see the feet on the ropes.
Yeah, and I don't know. Shawn Michaels actually got involved in the back at the end, because I believe Curt Hennig went looking for Lex Luger, and he got actually into, like, the loading dock area, and Shawn Michaels had switched into some jeans and super kicked him.
I think I missed that part.
Yeah, that happens in the back.
Well, that must have been the next storyline that comes up after this.
Right. They had a pretty long feud, and I don't know if that was the beginning of that feud or if it was their second feud or whatever, but so that didn't surprise me. I'd much rather see a Shawn Michaels-Curt Hennig match than I would to see any Lex Luger match, really.
I can agree with that.
I'm not trying to throw the man under the bus. I just wasn't a huge fan.
No, I wasn't a big fan of Luger's either. He just had... like an in-ring presence, though. He was another one of those showmen.
Oh, yeah.
In a way, like, more than a performer.
The coolest thing he ever did was power slam Yokozuna.
And that was that around the same time as this, or was that the next year?
I want to say that was the next year.
Yeah, I think it was 94 then. It was this kind of era, though.
Right. So that leads us to what most people probably remember as the biggest disappointment. Well, I don't know. Might be a contender there, but I see it as the biggest disappointment of this: Undertaker versus Giant Gonzalez.
Where do we begin with this one?
Let's start first. So, just so you know, the Undertaker has Paul Bearer with him, of course, and this is during some prime Undertaker stuff right here.
Yeah, his entrance was really good, too, and this was back in the old-school Undertaker outfit. I've always been a fan of the Undertaker, and even back then, he just had such a cool just way about him in the ring and with his entrance and Paul Bearer, all that stuff. Because I think he had the gray outfit back then, the gray,
gray and the black. He had the gray boots, the purple gloves, and the black outfit and the tie, right?
Yeah, the old-school like Undertaker that I kind of wish he would have kept, in a way.
It was just weird because you have Undertaker come out and he has this kind of flashy entrance and you got the giant vulture and everything. It's like, yeah, okay, cool. And then you have Giant Gonzalez come out and everybody's like, why is that dude wearing a painted suit? Like, that just doesn't.
It was like one big onesie or something.
I honestly wonder. I'm serious. I wonder because I know how these things are planned. You know, everything's rush, rush. And I wonder if they're like, oh, that sounds great on paper. Painted muscle suit. The guy's huge. He should have a lot of muscles. He'll look intimidating as hell. And then they see it and they're like, well, it's too late to change now. We're committed.
Yeah, with a guy that size, it's not like you could scrap an idea and have him throw on something else. I mean,
yeah,
he was like 7.5 feet tall or something, wasn't
he? He was taller than Undertaker, and Undertaker's not a small guy.
Yeah, he was probably close to a foot taller because, yeah, Gonzalez was definitely a tall guy.
Yeah. There's not much to say about this match. It's a shitty match. It involves a chloroform cloth, which I believe is actually how the match is, because the match ends in a DQ, and like it looks like it's going to end, and then Undertaker comes back out. It was just bad.
It was. I mean, when Undertaker, that whole comeback out thing, it was almost like the Undertaker wanted to add something more to the match because he knew how crap it was. Like, in my head, I'm like, okay, we can try to save this by doing some more. It's like, no, dude, just go backstage. It's okay.
I know Undertaker doesn't do a lot of interviews, like out-of-character interviews and stuff like that, but I'd really love to hear him actually talk about this match and just kind of give us an insight into, you know, because I'm sure he didn't book the match, but I'm sure he probably has some insights too. This is what I was trying to do.
I just mean, who came up with the idea for the chloroform, though? I mean, blatantly showing something that, really, that's
not that uncommon in wrestling. It's just, you don't, like we kind of said, is that something you want to pull off at a WrestleMania? And when you have somebody like The Undertaker and I mean,
no, that's what I mean.
Had to be better ideas.
Like, with guys of that size, you're going to throw the chloroform card at me. Like, I just, no.
Like,
but I guess they couldn't do any finishing moves on each other, though, either. Because of the size, I guess.
That's a good point. People who get too big like that, Great Khali is a great example, you know, they're not easy to take bumps.
Yeah.
You know, so.
It is what it is. It definitely stands out in our memory from that WrestleMania.
It's so weird to me looking back now and knowing what we know now after WrestleMania 30, where the Undertaker streak was broken by Brock Lesnar, and you look back and you see all these great opponents and great matches he had, you know, and then there's Giant Gonzalez. I guess there's just not much else to say about that.
Yeah, I think that match has been covered so many times with, it's just one of those matches that there's not much more we can even say about it. There's not much to say about it. It's just watch it. Just go spend 10 minutes, watch the match.
All right, I'm sure there's more to say about this, but that match has been discussed to hell and back, and I kind of want to talk a little bit more about the stuff that happened after this. So, last segment, Mean Gene Okerlund is in the back, and he's interviewing Hulk Hogan. And I want to see if you caught this line. So Hogan, you know, they're asking him, because he's former champ, they're asking him about the title match, which is coming up. The title match is between Bret Hart and Yokozuna. And Hogan's response, and I quote, "Whatever happens, I'm issuing a challenge to either you or the Jap, brother."
I'm pretty sure that's what he said. Pretty sure that's what he said.
Well, I know that's what he said. Unless they altered it somehow on the network, which I guess I wouldn't put it past him. Maybe he said something more offensive, I don't know. But it's one of those things where you don't think about it because no one else thought about it at the time. But you're like, wow, yeah. I know you know that motherfucker's name. You can't call him out by name.
Hogan had a rough day that day. He
really did.
He was just letting off some steam.
The other funny part that I just have to point out is, so they also let Todd Pettengill do his final thing with the fans. And he's interviewing all these different fans about, hey, who do you think is going to win the match? What do you think is going to happen? You know, who are you rooting for? And one kid just straight up doesn't respond. Like, I don't know if he was scared. I don't know if he thought Todd Pettengill smelled funny. I don't know what was going on. But he just straight up no-sells his question and doesn't respond.
And that kid is now famous, right? For standing up to him.
He should be more famous.
He should be.
All right, Kobe, I want you to introduce the title match. I want you to kind of set it up for me here. What do we have going on?
Well, we have Yokozuna facing Bret Hart in the championship match. So I guess, what is there really to set up to this? Yokozuna, Mr. Fuji, current title holder, facing against Bret Hart, who kind of deserves a title chance.
Kind of, yeah.
But at the time, I guess I could say I was more of a Yokozuna fan because I think I mentioned this before, but I'm not exactly the biggest Hart family fan. I know that kind of comes to a shock to a lot of wrestling fans out there.
It does, sure. I get it, I guess. Not everybody is a fan of everybody, but are you saying they're not good wrestlers or they're just boring to you or what?
I just meant it seemed like, I will say that, out of the Hart family, Owen Hart was definitely the performer that I enjoyed watching. I could watch Owen Hart matches. I thought the guy was phenomenal in the ring. But there was something about Bret Hart, even as a kid, that he just kind of bored me. Like, he didn't have a lot going on in the ring for me, because he was mostly a submission kind of wrestler. And it just, like, Yokozuna was more, okay, big power crush. Like, that was more my style watching wrestling back then.
Okay. So I don't have much to actually say about this match. For those of you who've never seen the match, and obviously if you're listening to this, you already know we're just going to spoil it for you. Yokozuna wins, but there's some issues with a torn turnbuckle. There's also, this is one of the more famous, uses of the salt in the eyes, something Mr. Fuji has been doing
Yep.
for a while. But, you see this one replayed a lot. And I do remember, I remember that this match, when I watched this the first time, it actually felt like a really epic match. Like, it felt like you had Bret Hart, whose build is supposed to be one of the best, like, technical wrestlers in the business, in the world at this time. And then
Yeah.
you have this guy who just feels unstoppable. I mean, this is Yokozuna. Like, I'm like you. I wasn't the biggest Yokozuna fan, but I was a Yokozuna fan, and I had friends that were big Yokozuna fans. So,
Mean, for Yokozuna's size, I mean, to be perfectly honest, that guy could move. He did a spinning heel
oh,
kick
yeah.
at 600 pounds. Like, are you kidding?
Also, if you listen to either Stone Cold Steve Austin or Jerry the King Lawler, any of them, they will say that Yokozuna was also like one of the nicest guys you could ever meet and not a stiff day at work. For those of you who may not know what that means, like if somebody's working very stiff, they can potentially bruise you or injure you because even though the moves are set up, and the stuff is predetermined, you still get hurt doing wrestling. But Yokozuna was supposed to be one of the easiest guys to work with as far as not hurting you.
Which is really surprising for a guy of his size.
They say that about a lot of the Samoan workers, that they can do stiff if you want them to do stiff, because some of those guys were crazy, especially if you listen to any of the Samoan SWAT team stories. But they're supposed to be really well trained, really good. Not stiff workers. So I don't know. He probably just fit that bill. What happens though? Let's talk about what happens. So
Do you,
Bret Hart is defeated.
yeah, I guess you could, yeah.
And Mr. Fuji's kind of happy. I guess he feels like his champion can't be beat. So he goes ahead and he calls out Hulk Hogan. And Hulk Hogan comes out, and basically Bret Hart's like, "Do it. Go finish this." So they have a second impromptu match. Now, a lot of fans probably felt pretty cheated by that first match, and I totally get that. So, I guess as an audience, you're looking at the second match as kind of making up for it, right? Cool. Yokozuna versus Hulk Hogan. Again, epic feel. Two big dudes. Should be a great 22 second match.
Oh yes, so much went down in those seconds.
What, tell me, what actually happened in that time, Kovac?
Well, let's see. The bell rang. Yokozuna grabbed Hogan. Mr. Fuji threw powder that went into Yokozuna's eyes.
Yeah, it backfired this time.
Backfired
Their
on him.
winning strategy.
Yeah. Hogan punched Mr. Fuji. I think he clotheslined Yokozuna. somehow a clothesline, all right, knocked Yokozuna down because he had salt in the eye or whatever it was.
I mean, you're talking about a guy whose big move is a leg drop, so...
Yeah, and then, of course, Hogan says, I'm going to drop my leg on you, and then he gets the win. And it's like, oh, so that just happened.
Did you notice how hesitated that last leg drop was, too? It was almost like he was questioning, it's like, I guess, should we go home now? Yeah, let's go ahead and go home now, you know? It's like he's thinking about it.
It was a good closeout, I guess, to make an overall mediocre sort of pay-per-view. It had to end that way to me. I couldn't have left that pay-per-view thinking, oh man, this is amazing. I had to leave on it, well, that happened. Cool. But I just wish they would have just let Yokozuna keep the belt at that point.
I agree.
It was just not worth that extra minute of just, who did Hogan pay off to say, I want the belt back, so let me go get it. Okay, go get the belt.
Well, interestingly enough, there were several rumors about why this happened. It's kind of confusing because Hogan doesn't hold the belt for that long. And there were apparently some rumors about whether or not Hogan would actually drop the belt to Bret Hart and whether or not, because I believe either Hart was injured or taking time off or something. There was a reason that they needed to not let Hart win this match. But Hogan had just returned. It probably seemed like the hot idea at the time. And Vince apparently has gone on record, like publicly since then, and said that there was no beef between Hogan and Hart, and there was no beef between, you know, the WWE and either one of the individuals at the time. It was all storyline stuff. Now, you take Vince however truthfully you want. You know, Vince sometimes comes across as a really straight shooter, and other times he comes across as somebody trying to protect his image and his business. So, you know, I don't know.
Yeah, I think Hogan just got a lot of whatever he wanted back then, and even to this day can still basically get what he wants.
Well, maybe not right now. Because
maybe not anymore with current situations.
But, yeah. I mean, after hearing him say he wanted the Jap, I am not surprised that Hogan's having trouble with that. I don't know why.
Oh, man.
All right, so that's it, though. That's WrestleMania 9. Let me ask you, overall, what'd you think, overall, as a pay-per-view?
Overall, like I kind of briefly said earlier, was that it was very memorable in that I still can remember this 20 years on. It's still there. It's not a great pay-per-view by any means. But with the outdoor environment, the Caesar's Palace, all the get-ups, all the entrances, and the just failures that occurred in some of the matches, I had fun watching it again. I was glad to go back and watch it. But it's not like a top 10 pay-per-view for WrestleMania by any means for overall wrestling ability.
And that's my next question. Like, you know, this one usually gets put pretty far down the list. Do you think this WrestleMania is as bad as everyone says?
From a wrestling standpoint, like actual good in-ring matches, it's not good.
What about an entertainment
standpoint? From an entertainment standpoint, I would not rank it all that bad. Like, I would probably put this more towards the upper half of WrestleMania's from just because of the memories of how bad some of the stuff was. Like, it's just memorable. Like, the joking, like I said, the outfits, all that kind of stuff, and with the way matches ended, it's just hard to really critique this one too badly on the entertainment standing, or the front from it, I guess I'd say.
All right, final question. If it was one person from this card that you would actually like to see wrestling again in the WWE today, someone who's not currently wrestling.
Or deceased, right?
Yeah, right, or deceased. Well, I mean, if you want to say Mr. Perfect, that's fine. I just don't see it happening. But who would you actually like to see if you could take one person and put them back in the WWE today?
To be perfectly honest, he's old now, but like I said, the Tatanka Shawn Michaels match. I know Shawn Michaels, he can be gone. That's fine. If Tatanka had a way to be back in wrestling, I would love to see that guy back to wrestling. Or
yep.
If Razor Ramon, Scott Hall, whatever you want to call him, if he could get his stuff fully together again, he was always an entertaining person to watch.
You actually stole my pick because I was going to say Scott Hall was on a WWE Network show not long ago. He was on Breaking Ground, and he just some of the stuff he was saying, you can tell that guy gets the business. Like he has the mind for it, as long as he's sober.
Yes.
But all right. So overall, I'm kind of glad that we sat back down and we watched this. Do you think watching this now, are you eager to watch this upcoming WrestleMania?
Well, I will say this. By getting back into wrestling now with this old match and trying to catch up on some of the newer stuff, because basically I missed 2015. Like basically I missed all of 2015 for
Right.
wrestling stuff. So I do plan on getting up to date with at least the last few months leading up to, because Royal Rumble's coming up in like a week, right?
Yeah.
I probably won't be able to get up to current events for before the Royal Rumble, but I definitely do want to be up to current like storylines and whatnot before WrestleMania in 2016. And I'll give it another go.
Okay. All right. Well, Kovic, if anyone wants to talk to you about your opinions of WrestleMania 9, or maybe try to convince you to, catch back up and get back into wrestling a little bit, where can they find you?
Well, I have three ways basically. It's all the same name, which would be Kovic Plays, one word with a Z at the end because I don't know why.
Because you
But
spell
it's
like the kids. Because you spell
because I
like the
spell like
kids.
the kids. But yeah, Kovic Plays is on Twitter, YouTube, and Twitch, all the same name. Feel free to like DM me on Twitter, talk to me on Twitter. That's by far the easiest way to communicate with anything. I check it probably 20 times a day.
Yeah, and I hear you play a lot of really bad games on YouTube.
I do. And I'm actually starting to get into Twitch a lot more now. I plan on streaming a lot more, getting back into the retro stuff again.
All right, cool.
Oh, also, one last thing I forgot to mention was little information here was that King Jerry Lawler actually made his Raw debut the night after this WrestleMania.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, you did tell me that.
Yeah, I just wanted to slip that in there at the end.
No, that works. I'm a Jerry Lawler fan, so I'm glad you brought that up. All right, well, I hope that you guys have enjoyed listening to us go back through WrestleMania 9. If you have any questions or if there's a WrestleMania or other pay-per-view you'd really like to see us do, let us know. You know where the YouTube comments are. You know how to find me on Twitter and all of that stuff that will be in the description below. So, till next time, Kovic, thanks for joining me.
Thanks for having me.
You guys have a good one.